Hi everyone, and welcome to the Somerset Mendip Circuit Digital Service of Worship during what should be the season of Pentecost, when we learn what it means to live a life inspired by the Spirit of God. So first we thought about the coming of God's Spirit at Pentecost. Next, we considered the Trinity and got to know a God that is in some mysterious way three and also one. And today, we consider the need to discern where God's Spirit is at work and to align ourselves with it. My name's Bethany. I'm a local preacher in the Somerset Mendip Circuit, a mum to my two sons, Billy and Lowry, who are both enjoying half term at the moment. And I'm speaking to you from our home church of Oak Hill, which is just slowly reopening and filled with tents right now as we try to find ways to welcome our children back and somehow keep them safe and socially distanced at the same time. So my life is a constant whirl of chaos and business and chasing my tail, but here at the very beginning of our worship, we pause to be still. We think for a moment of the very beginning of creation, when the Bible tells us that God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters. But we too are deep waters. And the Spirit of God was hovering. And so, we become aware of God's Spirit now. This Spirit that was present from the very beginning of creation and with us from our conception and has never left us from then to now. And we pray, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Breath of God, come. Breathe within. Wind of God, move among us with holy fire. And Lord God, we know in these moments that it's not you that shows up in our lives, for you are always with us, but it is us that show up. So make us aware of your presence now. Give us grace to step out of the darkness and into the light. Reveal to us that what we thought was our living room is in actuality your throne room. And as we show up in that throne room, finally aware, teach us how to worship you there. Amen.
Holy, holy, holy.
Amen.
Our first reading is from the Book of Psalms. It's a psalm of ascent, which means it's a song the Israelites would sing as they made their way up to the temple and into the presence of God, a way of preparing their hearts to enter God's presence. And so this song both describes and invites us to take part in a movement that's been taking place from the beginning of time until now, a movement from the darkness of the deep waters to the dawning of the first creation, a movement from brokenness into wholeness, from death into resurrection.
Psalm 130, a song of ascent. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than watchman for the morning, more than watchman for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities.
Our second reading is a story from the beginning of Jesus' ministry, when he's just chosen his disciples and his fame is beginning to grow. And so, without really taking a breath to pause or understand, two sets of people arrive at his house, more or less at the same time, both believing it's their job to control him. His family, convinced he's mad and wanting to shut him up before he shames them, and the religious leader, who think he's bad and want to get on with the shaming part.
Mark chapter 3, verses 20 to 30. Jesus is accused by his family and by the teachers of the law. Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, he's out of his mind. And the teachers of the law, who came down from Jerusalem, said, he's possessed by Beelzebul, by the prince of demons. He is driving out demons. So Jesus called them over to him, and he began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house unless they first tie him up. Then he can plunder the strong man's house. Truly, I tell you this, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They're guilty of an eternal sin. He said this because they were saying, he has an impure spirit. Thanks be to God for that reading. Amen.
I'm going to tell you my husband's favourite joke. What is the difference between a kangaroo and a kangaroot? I'm going to give you a minute to think it through. Turn to someone near you. A kangaroo and a kangaroot. Well, a kangaroo, I hope you all got, is an Australian marsupial. And a kangaroot is a Geordie stuck in a lift. A kangaroot. I can't do the accent. You don't have a hope of getting that joke unless you know the context. And all too often, the Bible is just like that. the nuances of the words, the places they appear before, the myriad connections from one text to the next will turn a few phrases into an endless whirling mystery of hope and promise. And Psalm 130 is just like that. The language is desperate to pull its original readers back deep into Genesis, into the stuff of myth and legend and poetry and the endless opening doors of truth. So, when we read these hackneyed, simple lines, it's so easy to misunderstand them and to miss the mystery. Out of the depths, I cry to you, O Lord, it starts. This is just where creation began. Right back in Genesis 1, I'm going to find it for you. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void. A darkness was over the face of the deep. The Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Out of the depths, I cry to you, O Lord. But also, in the psalm, this is the cry of an individual. And it's clear from the next line that this individual feels separated from God, cut off. That they seem to have the need to petition God, to beg, just to get God to listen to them, to incline his ear to them with favor. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ear be attentive to the voice of my supplications. Fully aware of their unworthiness of God, the next line searches for hope. In my Bible it says, Lord, if you mark iniquities, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be feared. The words, the original words here, are so important. To mark in this context, it means to keep, to watch, or to preserve. Hold on to something, to look at it, to focus on it. Lord, if you mark our iniquities, iniquity here is the word avon. It means a crookedness or a twisting. Sometimes we translate it as wrongdoing, sometimes as guilt, sometimes as punishment. It's Cain who first uses it after he kills his brother Abel and is sent to wander the earth. He cries out, my crookedness is more than I can stand. God uses it when he wants Lot to flee from Sodom and not look back, lest he get caught up in the crookedness of the city. It's important to imagine and to understand the imagery of the description. The idea here is not that a person is in some way bad or unacceptable to God, but that a person, a beautiful person, God's perfect creation, becomes twisted or out of kilter, out of shape in some way. And the point here is that this twisting is not what God marks or watches or preserves when he looks at that person. It's not his focus. If he did, if it were his focus, the psalmist says, who could stand? Instead, the psalmist says, in God, there is a fearfully abundant, full forgiveness. It is God's nature, the psalmist tells us, to untwist, to unburden, to pardon, to set free, to put things back, to bring a person back to standing. Like the sun will illuminate the darkness, so the image here is that as we enter God's presence, we will be put right. And that is surely a terrifying idea. And it's why we tend to stand back and treat God with caution. So, the psalmist advises us to wait. Wait for the Lord. Wait. The word wait here is a fascinating one. It pulls us back again into Genesis chapter 1, this time verse 9. After God has made light, he separates the sea and the sky, and then he says, let the waters beneath the sky flow together into one place so that dry land may appear. The word translated here, flow, sometimes is also translated gather. Let the waters gather together in one place so the dry land may appear. In this psalm, they translate it wait. Let the waters wait together in one place. And so you understand that this waiting has within it a kind of gathering, a kind of expectancy. It creates a space that something new may come. My soul hopes for the Lord, the psalmist tells us, more than watchmen for the dawn. And then he repeats himself, just so you don't miss it. You won't want to miss the devastating importance of this line. More than watchmen for the dawn. The root word for watchmen here is one we've already encountered earlier. It's the same word they use for mark. Lord, if you marked our iniquities, who could stand? It means to watch, to preserve, to focus on. At that point, it's noted that God doesn't focus on our failings, our imperfections, but rather loosens and untwists us. But here, we are given the picture of a watchman waiting for the dawn. Now, the fascinating thing about this is it is not the job, actually, of a watchman to wait for the dawn. The job of a watchman is to search, seek, focus on, watch, observe what is happening in the darkness. They are employed to scour the darkness for enemies, for wickedness, for wrongdoing, to keep the city safe. Their job is the sort of job we often wrongly picture God doing. But the psalmist points out, while that may be the paid job of a watchman, the reality of their job is different. Because whilst they may be watching for the enemy on the surface, at a deeper level, what they really do is wait for the dawn. When the dangers and the fears of the night are past, and their old job is rendered unnecessary. Israel. Hope in the Lord, the psalmist tells us. Notice he's bigger now. He's not just talking about him. He's talking about the whole of Israel. Hope in the Lord, for in God is unparalleled love, abundant redemption, the total loosening of every twist, the total freeing from all crookedness. And so the psalmist has taken us on a journey from a small self, which believes itself cut off from God, through a revelation about the nature of who this God really is, into a gathering, expectant waiting that blossoms into hope as the Spirit hovers. And then the dawn breaks through and rightness flows. This is an eternal promise of what it means to approach God, open to us in all circumstances. It's true then as it is now, and available to all. But now, we have to move on to Mark. Mark is a harder reading, complicated and confusing, an odd passage, a contradictory one. The scribes say to Jesus, well, say of Jesus, that he is possessed by the devil. He casts out demons by the prince of demons. And Jesus defends himself. He points out that if evil turns against itself, it won't prosper, it will fail. He points out that in order for him to cast out demons, he must first have tied up the prince of demons. So far, so simple. But then we get verses 28 and 29. Truly, I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the children of man, and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. So which is it? Can people be forgiven for everything? As the psalmist earlier suggested, as Jesus echoes, or can't they? As Jesus seemed to suggest afterwards. Of course, it's a translation issue. It's always a translation issue, because we need to understand that the word eternal doesn't always mean eternal in the Bible. It means of the ages, and sometimes an age can stop and a new age can come. And we also need to understand that Jesus is talking about the present here rather than the future, by which I mean that Jesus is saying that while all blasphemies can be forgiven, where the Holy Spirit is blasphemed, it is a marker that the person is not forgiven, is not living in forgiveness, is not in the age of newness and wholeness, but in the age of crookedness and brokenness. Eugene Peterson in The Message does a decent job of describing it. He says, listen to this carefully. I'm warning you. There's nothing done or said that can't be forgiven, but if you persist in your slanders against God's Holy Spirit, you are repudiating the very one who forgives, sawing off the branch on which you're sitting, severing by your own perversity all connection with the one who forgives. But whichever way we wriggle, we can't get away from the fact that Jesus gives a stern warning here. And it's a warning that if we take it seriously, will counsel us to take our previous psalm seriously too. There is a kind of mindset that trains itself on evil. It seeks it out, suspects it in everyone. It spots it, even when it's not there to be found. The watchman of the soul can go that wrong. It is possible to look at the Holy Spirit and see Beelzebub. To watch a paralyzed man stand up and walk and suspect foul play. To see the restoration of someone's hand and dismiss it as working on the Sabbath. Perhaps you've seen someone do this. Perhaps you do it yourself. It's common. I know I've done it. We credit those who are politically or religiously different from us with the very worst of intentions. Assume their goodness is a trick, their success is a con, and their destination is disaster. We become obsessed with their secret sins and their misconceptions, their mistakes. But this hardness of heart, grubbiness of eyes, is a sign that we are not led by the Spirit and that we do not live in the kingdom of a loving, forgiving, generous God. And Jesus warns us, when the watchmen of the soul train their eyes on the darkness only, they will miss the dawn. An obsession with crookedness will lead no one to the fearsome forgiveness of a God who only needs to be noticed to transform. I want to tell you the story of Mary Berry now. My brother has a YouTube channel where he likes to tell the stories of extraordinary people and the wisdom they have. And he and I work together on this particular one. I don't appear in the video, so you get to hear a different voice. But we did write and work on it together. And I hope you'll enjoy the life of Mary Berry, which is one I find inspiring.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mary Berry comes to me, speaking her words of wisdom, "Let it be." Mary Berry was born to a well-to-do family in Bath in 1935. Her father was to become mayor of Bath. She had servants, she lived in a big house, she went to a private school, she kept her own horse. It's easy to think that her rise to fame and success must have been easy. But if it's the last 50 years to publish 70 books, to survive tragedy, to earn a CBE, you're going to need more about you than a knack with pastry and some inherited privilege. You're going to need staying power. You're going to need endurance. Now, in early life, Mary Berry describes herself as something to be endured rather than enduring. She was slovenly, late, easily distracted, and writing out lines such as "empty vessels make the most noise" rather than simply doing her homework. But then polio struck. Aged just 13, Mary contracted the devastating disease. The condition attacked the nerves in her spinal column and in her brain, and muscle paralysis set in, which can lead to permanent paralysis or even death. Mary was placed in an isolation room for a month. And it took all her strength just to turn her head when her parents would come to see her and mouth things to her through the glass. And too ill to understand why they couldn't come and give her a hug, she just wept every visit. Polio was to leave Mary with a curved spine, a permanently weakened left side, and uncertain if she would ever bear children. But it also gave her a belief in her own ability to endure, a sense of the need to work hard. As she watched other children struggle and even die, she had to come to realise she was one of the lucky ones. Mary Berry's school results were disappointing. The only subject she had excelled in was domestic science, but she'd done so poorly everywhere else she couldn't even qualify to teach it. Her head teacher told her, "There isn't any career I can recommend to you, as you haven't passed enough exams to do anything." He told her parents her only option was a job looking after children, at which her father replied, "I pity the children." So how do you let it be? After her school and her parents wrote begging letters to Bath College, they agreed to take her on a course that she was unqualified to go on in order to teach her to become a caterer. But Mary Berry was hardworking and ambitious. She chose to fill all her spare time and holidays with unpaid work experience in butchers, in fishmongers, in hotels, bakers, everything to do with cooking. Even so, she remained poorly qualified and was glad after college to land a low-paid job with the electrical board in Bath. In the evenings, disappointed with her school results, she went back to college. Aged 22 and ready for a new adventure, Mary got a job inventing recipes in London. Her successes at work came slowly and only as a result of hard work and creativity. She convinced her employers to give her a month off to train at Cordon Bleu in Paris. And later, she reluctantly and worriedly filled in for a colleague by writing a cookery article. She was sure she was too bad at writing to pull it off. But of course, it was Mary's simple, clear writing style, using ordinary, humble ingredients and easy techniques, that enabled her to teach a nation how and what to bake. Determined both to make a living and to share her love of cooking with as many people as possible, she frequently worked two jobs. Mary married Paul Hunnings, age 31, and she got married in a £5 wedding dress and had a homemade our wedding cake. They saved all their money for a house. And after more than 50 years, as Mary says, thanks to working at it, they are still devoted to one another. Nevertheless, their lives together were not always easy. Mary was born with two uteruses and further weakened by polio, and they suffered multiple miscarriages. They sought medical help, continued to work and grieve, and Mary was overjoyed when eventually they managed to have three healthy children. The children, of course, proved to be just as mischievous and naughty as Mary herself. Yeah, that's slightly... But age 54, a moderate success, and with a few good cookbooks to her name, Mary was to show us all what real endurance and the ability to let it be really looks like. Her middle son, William, aged 19, came home on holiday and took their car and his little sister out to the shops. Driving too fast, he lost control and crashed. On that Saturday morning, a policeman came to Mary Berry's door and told her he was very sorry, but her son was dead and her daughter was in hospital. She went to tell her husband, and the police drove them to identify William's body. They were terrified that their daughter Annabel, too, might be lost. Thankfully, she was shaken but unharmed. Rather than collapse in their grief, that afternoon the family went to London to find their eldest son so that they might tell him in person and be together. Mary remembers how in the days that followed, she found herself, as was their custom, in church for the Sunday service and saw on the wall a plaque that read, "In honoured memory of Frederick, William and George, sons of Alfred and Emma Busby, they voluntarily gave their services to their country in 1914 and died for her in 1917. Mary Berry says in her autobiography, "After seeing that memorial, I would never dream of asking, why me?" When Berry speaks of William today, she says, "We have William for 19 years, and he was just such fun, and we have great, great memories." She also says how lucky she is to have her two other children safe and well, and her husband to comfort her. It took Berry a year to care about cooking after then, but she decided that because of her love of Argus, she might invite people round and teach them how to cook with one. On these days, she filled her kitchen to bursting, gave demonstrations, gave out homemade shortbread, and gave everyone a taste of what it was like to gather round an oven, a good meal, and care about each other. Of course, soon after, Mary Berry's endurance was to pay off when the Great British Bake Off started, and it rocketed her to fame and fortune and success. She lunched with the Queen, she accepted award after award, and she became loved by all of us. But Mary never lost sight of what her real aim was: to teach ordinary people how to cook a good meal.
In Psalm 130, we are shown a pathway, a road that Mary Berry also found. And people who find this pathway can travel it through all circumstances. It's the path through the depths to the dawn, through crucifixion to resurrection. It is the holy way. From the darkness of suffering and trouble, we cry to God, and gradually we realize that God is bigger than the ties that are binding us. Whether those ties come from illness, disappointments, mistakes we've made, losses we've endured, slowly we discover that God does not mark the crookedness as we do, that God sees beyond it and is able to redeem it. Slowly, gently, our soul gathers in expectancy. Slowly, its watchman changes its focus
from the scurrying of enemies in the night to the gathering of the endless dawn. And we find ourselves on the other side of the wakeful night, coming to rest in the light. This is a journey we travel from moment to moment, as well as it being the journey of our whole lives. But remember, the journey we take from the darkness into dawn must affect not just who we are, but who we believe others to be, how we see and understand them, how we prize and serve them, how we describe them, and what we believe about them. No one can love God and hate their neighbor. And if God has only to be noticed to transform, then to turn our eyes and notice evil instead is to close the door to transformation. But when we see Christ in others and treat them as image bearers of God rather than as sinners, we show them the door to the hovering and the waiting and the hoping and the dawning of the kingdom of God. Amen. We're going to sing a song now. The song is Breathe On Me, Breath of God. Lord God, we thank you that you have opened a pathway for us, a road to travel out of darkness and into light. So often, Lord, we want you to come and rescue us from suffering and remove it. We ask you to pull us back to the beginning. But that's not how you work. Instead, you call us through the night and on to the new dawn. Lord, we lay our night before you now. Whatever it is, the endless slog of parenting, a rough relationship, loss, physical pain, mess or muddle. The little watchmen in the soul, they love to focus on the bad and train their eyes upon it, but we know that over the swirling, eddying waters, your spirit hovers. Lift the eyes of our watchman, Lord, to see the dawn, we pray, that we may know you and hope in you, and that we, in our own small ways, may come to embody hope, to a lost world. Amen. We're going to come to our prayers of intercession. Lord God, we lift up to you those who find themselves in darkness. There are people we know who feel far from you, maybe who don't know you, maybe who are suffering and struggling. There are people we've heard of, situations we're aware of, things we've come across on the news. We know your Holy Spirit is always present, that it hovers over the waters. Lord God, we pray for those in darkness, that you would move them into hope. Lord, we pray for those who are waiting and hoping now. Those who are waiting for the restrictions to change. Those who are waiting for their circumstances to change. Please send your Holy Spirit, Lord. Be with those people who hope. May they see signs of the dawn. And Lord, now we pray for those who bring hope. Those we know who are called to work with those in trouble. We pray for leaders in the church and of countries. We pray for teachers, doctors, nurses, comedians. Send your Holy Spirit to all those who go out to do your work. Fill them anew. Amen. My final song is I Need Thee Every Hour.
Every hour, stay thou nearby.
Our blessing today is taken from the breastplate of St. Patrick, and it's a reminder of what it means to have the Holy Spirit within us. Christ with you. Christ before you. Christ behind you. Christ in you. Christ beneath you. Christ above you. Christ on your right. Christ on your left. Christ when you lie down. Christ when you sit down. Christ when you arise. Christ in the heart of everyone who thinks of you. Christ in the mouth of everyone who speaks of you. Christ in every eye that sees you. Christ in every ear that hears you. And so we arise today through our mighty strength, the invocation of the Trinity, through belief in the threeness, through confession of the oneness of the Creator of creation. Amen.